After Catherine Howard's execution in March 1542, the court was back to business as usual. Henry would host a series of banquets for members of his privy chamber and lords. But despite this, he did host a ladies-only event, which he appeared to thoroughly enjoy. Henry was happy once more. His gloomy disposition following all of the difficulties with his previous wife had been washed away on a wave of intense pleasure.
Because the king was without a wife and queen once more, by November, the Lady Mary would preside over most of the court entertainment herself. The king, on the other hand, was more preoccupied now that his resurgence had come to an end, at least for the time being. More urgent times lay ahead, particularly in light of the fragile relationship with Scotland, which was rapidly deteriorating and threatening to devolve into a war. To prevent James V and his army from crossing the border into England, Henry would dispatch an army to the north of the country. Norfolk and his son Surrey would attend the scene, with reports indicating that both had put in good shifts.
On November the 24th, the Scots were defeated at Solway Moss. Norfolk was one of the first to congratulate himself, stating that the victory was made possible by his outstanding leadership. Hertford was also on the field that day, and according to reports, he deserved some recognition for his own bravery and skill. But to Henry, none of this mattered, because he had triumphed, and life at court was now filled with joy as things began to turn around. On the 14th of December, it was announced that James V had passed away. This latest turn of events provided Henry with even greater pleasure. He was now ecstatic because the news meant that Scotland had now been taken over by a one-week-old baby girl. Her name was Mary, Queen of Scots.
In the new year of 1543, Surrey was embroiled in a new round of trouble in the capital. He went on a drunken rampage through the streets one night after celebrating the Solway victory. He smashed the windows of aldermen's homes and hurled stones at onlookers as he walked by. Nonetheless, Surrey's brashness would once again be brought to the king's attention, and he would be punished. While on trial, he admitted to the crimes but claimed that he had only broken the windows of papist houses. Well, that's all right then. He was remanded to Fleet Prison for a period of time to allow him to cool off and learn to control his irritable crimes. Even Henry was adamant that Surrey needed to change, and he referred to him as the most foolish proud boy in all of England. However, he remained fond of Surrey, and he may have attributed his enthusiasm to simply youthful exuberance.
In February, the king began to show an interest in a new lady, Catherine Parr. She was at the time the wife of John Neville, Lord Latimer. Catherine, in contrast to her predecessors, was an intelligent, mature woman with a good education, and perhaps Henry had finally found someone in whom he could put his trust in. Catherine was born around 1512 and spent the majority of her early life in London. She had been married twice but had no children from either of these marriages. The petite Catherine possessed a pleasant and upbeat personality. She was a good conversationalist and she was respected for her dignity and moral character. The death of Catherine's second husband occurred on March the 2nd after a long illness, and it was now or never for Henry to make his move.
Catherine held radical political views, and it is possible that she held Protestant religious beliefs, so she had to exercise caution when in the company of certain people. Miles Coverdale and Hugh Latimer were frequent visitors to her home. However, the Lady Mary, a devout Catholic, would also pay her a visit. And although Mary and Catherine had been good friends since they were children, it was still difficult to hold certain viewpoints, especially when individuals such as Gardiner, who was supported by Wriothesley, were ruthlessly hunting down heretics and traitors within the royal household.
A member of this group was John Marbeck. He was a secret Calvinist who was found guilty and sentenced to death by burning at the stake. But the king, on the other hand, intervened and threw John a lifeline. You see, John was a talented composer and organist, and he served Henry well, and a man who was held in high regard by the king would be pardoned. But three others, on the other hand, were not so fortunate. In April, the attention shifted to Thomas Cranmer. Gardiner had accused him of heresy, yet he had denied it. Once again, the king stepped in to save the day. Cranmer would accept Henry's invitation to accompany him on a trip down the Thames, but when they boarded the boat, Henry said in a light-hearted tone, "I'm sorry, my chaplain, but I have some bad news. I've discovered who the most atrocious heretic in Kent is." Despite the fact that Cranmer was terrified, Henry assured him that he would be protected from his adversaries. Cranmer received a ring from Henry, who instructed him to show it to the council if they came looking for him.
Council members arrived the next day to arrest Cranmer. Despite this, Henry stood up for his forlorn friend, stating that rival political parties should make peace. Sir Thomas Seymour would also have to pay a high price for his remarks about Cranmer's character, declaring he was an immoral man who had neglected his responsibilities as head of a household, and his entertainment was far below the standard expected of a dignitary of his stature. On the basis of his words, Seymour lost his revenue and was instead compensated with a salary. In the course of dinner, Henry warned Seymour that any further nonsense of this nature would come back to haunt him personally, and then added, "There shall be no alteration while I am alive."
Gardiner was enraged by the king's intervention. He was persistent and determined to rid the court of these reformists and heretics because they were confident that Catholics would retake control under the new queen, Mary, and their plan now was to wait until the king died.
William Paget rose to prominence in 1543 when he was appointed secretary to the king. Paget, on the other hand, chose to keep his religious beliefs to himself. He exerted a tremendous amount of influence over Henry, and many of the things that happened behind the scenes would end up granting him great wealth and the ability to exercise power, leading many people to believe that he was simply too good to be true.
It wasn't just Paget who was advancing in his profession. Additionally, Anthony Denny would have a growing influence on Henry, to the point where he would eventually be knighted in 1544. He would be in charge of the Privy Chamber and would serve as a confidential advisor to the monarch. Denny was a man of words and spoke out bravely about the persecution of Protestants. Gardiner and his factions were filled with resentment, but they were helpless to remove him from his position of power. At this point in his life, Henry had become extremely irritable and opinionated. According to him, the final word on religion belonged to him, and him alone. Henry would recall his younger days. He admired humanist ideas and was a supporter of the new learning. Nonetheless, it's possible the toxic environment in court was not apparent to him. In contrast, the people who would bow were vehemently opposed to his methods, possibly believing in heretical religious beliefs.
The year 1543 would mark the publication of Henry VIII's book, The King's Book, which had been written under his supervision and with portions written in his own hand. It was Henry's most reactionary statement to date about his church, but he couldn't go back in time, and a lot of water had already passed under the bridge by this point. Newly released English versions of the Bible would allow subjects to think for themselves, allowing them to go beyond the strict Catholicism they had previously adhered to.
Despite this, Henry's book did not make it onto the bestseller list. His statements about his bias and expectation towards morality were ridiculed. Paget came to the king's aid and he was able to reassure him that the majority of his subjects were orthodox. Gardiner, on the other hand, would have none of it and exclaimed that it was just not enough, urging the king to put a stop to the broad reading of the Bible. The Act for the Advancement of True Religion would be enacted by Parliament, and Henry agreed that translations were now off limits to the general public, with access limited to only the upper classes and nobility.
Henry's thoughts may have been elsewhere when it became known that another man at court was guiding Catherine Parr's hand as well. Sir Thomas Seymour paid her frequent visits and was a great admirer of her. The next time she would confess, it would be years later. She said, "As truly as God is God, my mind was fully bent the moment I was at liberty to marry you before any other man I know."
But Henry never lost his edge. In May, he would dispatch Seymour to Brussels, which would be followed by a military campaign in the Low Countries. Catherine's fate had now been sealed. In late June, both Catherine and her sister had become regular visitors to the court, and there was little doubt in the minds of many courtiers that she was destined to be Henry's sixth wife. Thanks for watching History Roadshow. Don't forget to smash that like button, subscribe and hit the notification bell so you never miss a new video release.